Alexa, open BraveWords Radio.
Welcome back to BraveWords Radio. Brought to you by Vox Protocol, the global leader in voice app entertainment. BraveWords Radio is an awesome musical extension of BraveWords.com, where we have been waving the flag of hard rock and heavy metal around the world for over 30 years. Since you have been here before, we hope you enjoy BraveWords Radio.
So please welcome to Brave Words, streaming for a vengeance, Mr. Alex Krull from Atrocity and Leaves Eyes fame. It is such a pleasure to have you, sir. How are you doing?
Thank you, Tim. I'm doing great, and I hope everything is fine with you in Canada.
Well, we were talking on the cruise, that was the last time I saw you in person. The weather is a little bit different here because I just finished shoveling about 2 feet of snow right now, literally.
Oh, shit. Okay, you know, I came back from the boat. Lousy weather in Germany, and then some days later I had to go to the Alps in South Tyrol for Graveform to shoot a video. And okay. It was like the guys told me, you're back from the boat, beware, we have minus 15 degrees.
Exactly. Exactly. give me like a little Cole's notes on, do you enjoy the cruise experience? It was a big deal because we haven't had it in 3 years. So the party went from here to here and everyone was so excited.
Yeah, it was amazing. It was absolutely great. And even if some things were not rolling like usual, of course, there was a 3 year break and there was some delays and stuff, whatever. That was absolutely brilliant, and it was so great to see everyone. You know, like us, for example, we had a fantastic talk at the bar about all the history with the band and all. It was awesome, and I have to say, I missed that so much. And as we were also not lucky with the Atrocity, in the summertime, we had, gig scheduled. There was the war with Ukraine and Russia, so we couldn't go there and play. And then the other festival was like when I got Corona. You know, I was going through the whole pandemic and then I got it in the summer. And so, yeah, exactly when we were supposed to play. So there was the first shows for Atrocity since 2019.
Wow.
And then even having release shows on 70K. With the brand new Okkult III album, that was like the best thing you could have. A little reward after all the painful years, I have to say. A little one. It was awesome.
And you took the reins from Mr. Jeff Waters in orchestrating the All-Star Jam. How is it dealing with it? I don't ever feel any ego on that cruise. So, you know what I mean? So I can't ask you how many egos did you have to deal with, because I doubt you had any to deal with.
Yeah, now the third time I'm doing this, I think. I did it also the last years, so before Corona, and it's absolutely a pleasure. Also, a lot of the guys I know, and so we have great talks, and there's like some diva, so to say, when people tell in advance, oh, Alex, because I have another concept. I like to talk with the guys playing and have some anecdotes on stage or something for people, what they maybe not hear usually from people like live on stage. So that's something, some of the guys getting nervous, so they're very handy. So, you know, I talk with them, we have like something to prepare, and then I already tell the guys, hey, be ready for that. It could be you or you or you. I pick out and we have a little talk about some stuff. And then, oh my God, what are you going to ask me then? And then it's different to be a musician playing. And then you have a microphone and you have to speak, right? So I have great fun doing this. And it was so far fantastic. And people tell me they love it. Andy told me that's fantastic. And the team behind, like Allison and Vincent, like the guys from the boat, they're super happy with that. And Yeah, probably I will host some more SMDK All-Star Jams.
What could you name like your top three covers when you're doing these jams? What's the most fun song to cover?
Oh my goodness, as the others have to play, because I said I will not join the jam when I have to host it, like 1.5 hours talking and also preparing. That's a tough question. Of course, it's always cool to hear if I see the Iron Maiden banner here in the back. When they play some Maiden, you know, people always demand that Black Sabbath, and AC/DC was also cool this time. So, yeah, it's hard to say the list of songs or like the ones chosen that's getting tiny and tinier as we don't want to repeat songs. Right. Some people don't understand probably why they play this song of that band. Could have been this or that song, which is maybe whatever played in another year already. So let's see how that goes in the future with that. And yeah, I think this year was a cool selection of songs, like a song from Rush, you know, people were not really expecting that this will be played, for example. But right. Then you have Chaos, you have Modad with Schmier. I told him, hey, you have to come to the All-Star Jam and you have to do your duty with no class. So
nice. That's awesome. Well, let's finish talking about covers and let's talk about new material. And you've kind of put a bow on the Okkult trilogy. 10 years is a long time to stretch out a concept. I know you can kind of give or take 2 or 3 years where nobody could do anything, but you could still record, right?
Yeah. We actually did that. there was a phase where I could have only one guy coming here to master sound to record or right. compose. So actually, you're right with that. It was not planned to have like a full decade, you know, with the three albums. Now, as it happened, I have to say with the results, what came out and the product and everything looks fantastic and it sounds great. I'm super happy. So because in the madness of Corona, we were releasing the last Viking release, Eyes, and we had a lot of troubles with that. So maybe it was even good to push back the Atrocity release because it was delayed twice. So that it came out now in January. And now everybody got the release. The box edition was there in time. Everything went smoothly with that. While with Leaves Eyes, we were like in the trend charts in Germany on 5, iTunes at number 1, and then the album couldn't be delivered. And then it happened, then we were like in the 20s or something in Germany. And right. that was a big bummer in a way, because you gave everything, you made everything for the fans. I felt the most sorry because they didn't get the stuff in time. So they had wait for weeks because of the chaos with Corona.
Right.
Let's hope this is over with that.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Now, it is a pretty mean-spirited and blood-soaked record, Okkult number 3.
I mean, the thing is, you know, a lot of people, they also sometimes get this kind of misinterpretation that it's only about that or a religious thing, or, you know, the occult has such a wide variety with the themes and topics and all that. But it is... it's the most brutal one. So I think there's no doubt. So I'm, you know, how you say that, it's very pleased with everything. So, and we have, of course, the occult topics demand some bloody stuff. So.
Well, the world is a terrible place. And even now there's examples of it, as you just referenced. Tom Araya always gave me one quote that I've taken with me. And he said, we've lived on this planet for thousands of years, but we still can't fucking get along.
You see, that is actually what I have this same thing in mind, you know, that is the concept of occult, is the dark side of humanity, it's the dark history of humanity. Of course, the mysteries like necromancy, all the, you know, ghosts and paranormal stuff and supernatural, that's all also part of that. But also conspiracies through human history, if you see what was going on with murders and all for power, greed, might, to control people, to manipulate them. You know, the biggest thing, you see it also nowadays, to manipulate everyone is fear. Whatever political system, whatever religion, almost, you control people with fear. And that is something going on also nowadays. And we have the song Fire Ignites. You know, it's like the world is on the cliff. It's you know, it can totally swap and we erase ourselves from the planet. We are facing this in fact since the Cold War. And people were swearing, oh, no more war. And in the middle of Europe, never, ever going to happen again. Here we go again. And the whole world is affected by that. And it's like every day you get a new horrible news about these war crimes and stuff like that. And I have to say, the metal community, the metal family, we have like 71 countries on the boat, right?
Right.
International, right. Everybody gets along. We get along. We have the music to celebrate. We have like whatever. Of course, there are discussions, this band is better than this or whatever, and sometimes it's a little bit over the top and bashing and all that. But in general, that's the best example how the world could go, right? In a way that people find a level, and in this case, it's our music and our lifestyle, to get along with each other. I don't make a, okay, heavy metal is a religion, but I say in heavy metal, the law number one is breaking the law. It means there is the freedom, you know, freedom of creativity, of art, of lyrics and all that. And we live the dream, you know, we know that we are having a special gift with this scene. It's not, especially in times like that, I don't take this for granted. I'm absolutely thankful, absolutely thankful. Visiting 50 countries with this band, 5 continents, I would never have seen any of this. Meeting people like you from the other end of the world and being in Australia or in El Salvador or in Japan or in China or in Russia. I've been there. If people want to tell me now that all Russians are assholes, I say no. Because I know also people, friends from us, they don't agree with the regime there at all. They are in danger. They got even imprisoned. We have crew guys from 2 crew guys in Kiev. We have Ukrainian crew. On 2019 tour with Atrocity, they were with us. Right. And they were sitting in a tour bus and they're telling me already about what's to come. We were like, really? They say, yeah, the guys will invade. This oligarch mafia regime, they will invade.
Wow.
And we were like, not so sure. And then you saw what happened. I think even the day before the invasion, nobody really believed there will be like a war like this coming. It's more like, you know, showing strength and frightening the enemy or whatever. And yeah, and that's the point. We are having this, like, also the world before Corona is not the same. Without the war also, it wasn't the same. And now on top of this, we just crushing into the next crisis, which is bitter enough. But I think what we can celebrate is our music, is our scene. We have like all the warning signals already with the metal covers back then, the artworks in the 80s. You saw it all, you know, people, they could not say somebody has not warned them. It was always the metal guys. They knew what's going to come.
Right, peace sells, but who's buying, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, there you go. That's a very good example, by the way. It's like all kinds of things. We were, also in our lyrics with the new album we were dealing with, and it's quite amazing how history repeats itself.
Now you wear so many hats, and the visuals with this new record and all the video production, that's a big deal in your world. I was really curious how that felt, and like, who over time has inspired you to be like a director like that? Because that's a big deal, right?
Yeah, it's something. I also film other bands, and of course, I wanted to, you know, be the guy directing everything also with the Atrocity videos on Leaves Eyes and stuff like that. And in a way, I see, like, in general, the band Atrocity, also Leaves Eyes, we're painting pictures with our music, right? So the visual aspect is always somewhere there. And as my sister Yasmin was a film director and having a video production company back in the 90s, she was doing Hammerfall, Morpheus, and all kinds of bands. Also, her company did Atrocity, for example. And she was also guest with us, but she did like a lot of bands, Sky, like Lacrimosa, whatever. I connected her back then also with the metal labels, with Nuclear Blast, Massacre Records, and so forth. So there was probably a big kind of route doing this, influence or education, you want to call it like that, because it happened also that I was there with the cutting of the videos, and also she was a director and all that, and we talked about things and story scripts and how to do that. I made even film music for her films and stuff like that. So that is something was always for me there, to have also like in the artwork and all that, have like a visualization of the music from what we're writing and what we're doing. So that's a natural thing, so to say. I know it's demanding, it's challenging every time, especially video productions with tiny budgets for metal bands. You have to have good ideas to bring it all up. But I want to have quality. No, I rather skip a project. Or I'm not a big fan of lyric videos. Everybody knows that. I'd rather do a film. Like Mrs. Succubus is like a short movie already, you know, not only having a band performance or not having that at all, you know, but having like a story-based movie. I like that very much.
Now, you've been aging and raging 40-plus years. You're like the ultimate survivalist. What's the key to survival? I actually have brought this up to a lot of people. I find one key to survival in the music business is having a sense of humor.
Yeah, that's for sure. Yeah,
right?
I have that. Yeah, probably the British have the black humor. You know, you have to have that. That's for sure. For me, it's also like really this driving force inside of me. The flame still burns bright, like, you know, like back when we formed the band. I had already a vision what we want to do, and not to be just a normal band, so to say, be extreme in one way, but be also very creative and working with other artists and all that. And that's my lifestyle, that's my life. I'm in the middle here of the studio, and I work also with other bands. That's what I love to do. It keeps me fresh and alive and vital. And this is also something when we go on tour and we get this energy from people, or also like from also talks like we had on 70K. It gives you something back. It's yeah. Something you taught me so much stuff, what you experienced with our music. You had like all the album covers there, and each album had its own story, so to say. That's yeah. That's amazing. And also when we meet colleagues or other musicians, and they also inspire me, we inspire them, you know, it's like, you know, you give something, you get something back. That's basically it. And that, you know, this driving force, you know, to express yourself as a metal artist, that's probably the main thing for me. So.
And you've been very open-minded. Like, you have a very, where do you think your open-minded soul has come from?
I have to say, my parents, they were absolutely fantastic. Sadly, my mother died last year. My father died, when the first Okkult came out already some years back. So,
sorry.
They were like conservative people or whatever, but very open-minded. So that was never like something they would forbid me to do, like when I decided to become a metal musician and all that. Also my sister with her film and art and stuff like that. They were very supportive with that, I think. They were also there in times when it was difficult, I have to say that, absolutely. And my mother was famous for all the death metal bands. If it punches Dench or Napalm Death or Disembodied Orchestra, Entombed, Dismember, Carcass, name it. Morbid Angel, they all have been in my house and my mother was cooking spaghetti for everyone. And that was, everybody knew, it was a melting point. When nobody wanted these metal kids at my house, my parents' house, they were welcome. Sometimes we had like 20 people or whatever in the middle of the week, just hanging out and stuff like that.
Is that common knowledge?
I don't know if it's common knowledge, but
is now.
I don't know. There's the documentary, The Godless Years from Atrocity. If people want to know more, they can go and watch it. It's also on YouTube. Just in case somebody's interested. It's a little bit of history of also the German death metal underground scene and how it all evolved and stuff like that. You can find a little bit of that. And that's probably why I was always also with other artists very interested also. How do they do their stuff and how could we combine stuff and bring some refreshment to the sound and stuff like that. That was always my thing. Also with German lyrics and stuff when people were accusing us to use that. I was like, hey, well, we're going to use it because it sounds great.
I had a great conversation with Wolf from Accept about learning English in Germany and how important it was to learn the English language. Do you remember taking those classes and did you struggle? Like, your English is great, but you know what I mean? Like, how important was it to learn English?
It was very important, of course. And yeah, let me tell you that, you know, world language, English, in a way, with the musical background and also to understand everything lyric-wise and stuff like that, was very important from the start, you know, because for us, the metal fans, we, and I was starting to listening to hard rock. There was no metal, and I was like 6 years old or something. Like, Deep Purple were my heroes, and then Pink Floyd, and not metal, but, you know, absolutely huge. Iconic band. Yeah, huge. And influential also for metal bands. And all that, when it grew with the music, was always important for me that I could catch up with everything, you know, also with the lyrics and stuff, because I'm a lyric guy too. So the thing is, I remember, and I also remember in school, and a funny story is here, that later this artist, I was working at the record company as his A&R, was King Diamond. And in my teenager days, I had the gift to have a presentation of King Diamond's songs for translation in English lesson.
So really?
So I suggested that we go through his lyrics, and it was quite amazing.
Because, like, growing up in Canada, like, in English, and you're hearing all these classic bands, whether the Beatles or Cream or Hendrix and Priest and all this stuff, like, I can't imagine growing up in Germany or some non-English speaking environment, and then you hear a band like the Beatles, and I'm like, they're not singing in German, they're singing in this language, you know what I mean? English. It might have been the first time you've heard the English language was through song.
Yeah, that's true.
Or movies.
Yeah, the thing is, in Germany, they dub the movies. It's a little bit shitty. So when I watch things, I think it's super important to have the original audio and everything. I swap it for Game of Thrones, for example. Can't watch this in German. It has to be in English. And that is something with dub movies. This, like in Scandinavian countries, they don't use that so much or even at all. I'm not sure they have subtitles. But as Germany is a huge country, so that's, you know, like the industry is preparing dub versions of that. So, but it was the music for sure. The music was a very big influence for that and also motivation to understand everything and to learn the language. And of course, when we were having, you know, the context within the metal scene, like to America, Canada, or, you know, UK, wherever, other countries too, we were writing in English to Swedish guys in the tape trader times, or to the guys in France, wherever. So that was actually already that the connection. Okay, some could speak German or learned it in school and stuff like that. But probably, you know, Elena, for example, she lives in Germany and we still talk English. And she's from Finland, yeah, a Finnish singer.
Now, you're talking about the beautiful packaging with Okkult. What do you think about this LP frenzy? And I actually want to take it back to your family and your folks. Like, do you remember growing up with vinyl and those inspirations? Do you remember like a particular record? It could have been the Bee Gees or, I don't know, the Beatles or something that your folks had on LP.
Okay, my parents, they were listening to music I certainly was not into. So I was the guy with the record player also. Maybe my sister had one, yeah. But I remember very well, Made in Japan with Deep Purple. I celebrated the record and probably it was like, you know, after so many times of listening to that, already a little bit screwed down. But the thing is with the Pink Floyd, The Wall, I think that was the first album I bought myself. Must be this one.
Okay.
Yeah, I was getting as a gift or something. And I had cassettes. But the vinyl was celebration. And you know, The Wall, that's probably an inspiration why I made so many concept albums with my own bands. Yeah. Because that is like the masterpiece. You know, that is a concept album. And also the artwork and everything, the details and the handwriting, everything was splendid and still is a absolutely classic. It was funny, I was driving with my son to was it Gamescom, and the other one was like we were driving to a video shoot where he assisted me for Blood Red in a NATO a former NATO headquarter bunker near to Rammstein. So it was quite a drive to there, and I gave him some history lessons for music. So we went through the catalog, so to say, and he also asked me how was it back in the day and all that, because he's used to the streaming and everything. They're completely missing out the vinyl part, so to say. And I think if I get the Okkult III album and I have that, you know, in full size and everything, it's that's the art comes out right there, right? You have it in your hands. A physical product, and you know, you can touch it, you can put the vinyl on all that and celebrate it. Although I have to admit, as you know, I'm in the studio and all that, I really have the time to go into my vinyl player at the very end and listen peaceful to stuff. Mostly it's I'm controlling everything correct. Is it right? Is it the sound I mastered? Is it did they do everything right? That's more like I have to listen to it in a professional way.
Well, growing up in Germany, The Wall must have been such a powerful statement when you bought that record as a kid.
Yeah, there's a story behind that as well, if you want to hear that. My father was actually from the East. And he came over to the Western part in the mid-50s or whatever, before the war. And when I was a kid, that thing was really a big, big topic we talked about. Because my father was hunted by the Stasi. So like the communist secret police, our secret service, but police actually. And they wanted to arrest him. So he had to hide in a car, in the back of a car. They drove him out. And in Berlin, Alexanderplatz, the Alexander Place, he went over to the West. So with the train, that time it was still possible to go from that station. So my name, now you know it. And the other thing is that that was indeed also when the album came out and I saw like the bricks of the wall and all that, that was for me a much more symbol. And when it happened, I organized back in the day in 89, I organized concerts also. And I organized the Godflesh tour in Germany. And one show was in Berlin. And I think it was just when the wall came down, I organized, it must have been Godflesh, a show. And I went to the wall when, like some days later, when they were already climbing over and all and celebrating on the wall. So I was at the Brandenburg Gate, and there was actually not many people when at all. It was really in the middle of the night. So I climbed up to the Brandenburg Gate. I could see it in front of me. And I couldn't believe I could do this, right? Because my father always told me about the area he comes from. He comes from the Baltic Sea coast, in Pommern, in Greifswald. It's northern east, almost on the border to Poland. There were parts that were actually German. They are now nowadays Polish. We have that song Szybka about a guy from Szczecin, where my grandfather was policeman. Yeah. So anyway, so don't stretch it too much. But I was on the wall, and suddenly there comes these two police guys from Eastern German police. Hey, you have to go down or whatever. And I couldn't hold on myself anymore. I said, "Fuck you, bastards! Fuck you! Fuck your system! You are fucking history. Go and fuck off. You're fucking crap." You are gone. You're history. Nobody needs you anymore. Go and fuck off. Fuck yourself. I was enraged. And suddenly I hear from down from the wall two Western policemen. Hello, young kid. And I said, what the hell? And they said, you better come down. And by the way, these guys, which are history, they still have guns. So... So I said, hey, okay. I said what I wanted to say. And then, I went down the wall. My girlfriend was there. She was like, oh, my God, Alex. I said, yeah, well, somebody has to say it.
Wow. Dude, that's amazing. Holy shit. My God. Did you actually ever consider grabbing a piece of the wall and putting it in your pocket?
Yeah, I didn't want to have that. But what I wanted to have, I was talking with Mille about it, with Creator. Just on the boat, I think it was, we had a conversation. And I told him, I think they were like the first guys over doing a thrash concert. We were the first guys playing a death metal show with Carcass. And it was still DDR, it was still Eastern German Republic. Still then, the democratic, well, that is a joke to call that. And they were in I think it was in Dresden, and we were that was a goal for me, that I will be going back with my music playing there for the fans. It was amazing, by the way. And that was something also to play in the hometown of my father. He wasn't there then. I called back in Southwest Germany when we played in Greifswald finally. I said, where have to go? Where are you living? And then all that. And he said, you don't know this street. You have to go around that corner. And that was amazing, you know, like that was real history. And the people were waiting for us. They knew us, you know. There was some radio shows going on, like in the last years. We did interviews with the guys. DT64, it was called. And... yeah, it was quite amazing that there was like already a scene waiting for, you know, us coming over and playing there.
That's so amazing.
And wow. That's the final word on this is like Roadrunner Records made a sampler compilation called Thrash the Wall. And with the goal to support Eastern German bands. And I was the guy going over with the profit of the sampler sent by Roadrunner to go to a Berlin studio, and I recorded four underground bands from Eastern Germany.
Really? Wow, dude, the history here. Holy shit. So amazing.
Yeah.
Let me just a couple more quickies. I don't want to keep you here all day. Maybe not struggles, but breaking it into North America with both your bands. The challenges.
The first thing is, of course, to enter the U.S. is the visa thing. It is a huge amount of work, and you spend months, and you hear it here and there. Somebody was declined, or they didn't make it in time, all that. That's really, it's a struggle, and a big hassle as well, of course. And, of course, because of the distances, the cost of touring is very high and all that. But if you're there, the people, the audiences, Canada is a metal country. The United States, it's fantastic. The people are so grateful. I love to tour North America, although it's demanding, although it's challenging and exhausting, also like six, seven weeks going on tour, you know, and hardly a day off or whatever. But I really love to do it. And I hope now after this Corona madness, we had plans already with both bands. Now I hope we get the chance as soon as possible to come back and play. That's for sure.
And you will always have BraveWords support when you do it. So we will help you promote it all. Okay?
Yeah. Thank you so much, Tim.
Last question, I guess. What does the future hold? Give me like a little rollout 2023, if you can.
Yeah, I can. I hope, yeah. as we done now, the videos and all that, the album is out, of course, the part which is missing are the live shows. So we are now really in preparations of festivals and tours. And there will be some specials also coming out now in the next couple of weeks from with the background from video shoots, but also like from the lyrical concept and stuff like that. We keep people updated with this. And the main goal is to have the tours going for this record and the treasure hunt. The Okkult treasure hunt is still going on. You know, each album has a bonus track hidden on a 24-karat golden CD. And, yeah, it's something going on. There's no time limit or something, like Indiana Jones. You know, it has to be something very special until people find it. And we have to see if the first one is over. I didn't check it now for a while. If yes, then we start the second one, which is North America.
This is like kind of like a Charlie and the Chocolate Factory kind of deal, the golden ticket thing?
No, it's like geocaching. You have hints. You have to, you know, if you have the CD or use everything explained on our webpage. There's also a trailer on YouTube. You have, there are hints like on the CD, and with the hints you can log in and then it will tell you where to go to find the next hint. You have to solve riddle and then you have to go again. And these are all occult places in Europe. We had like 6 countries involved. And then, like I said, there will be the next treasure hunt. We'll be in North America.
Nice. Very exciting. Thank you so much. You're such a treasure. You really are.
Thank you, Tim, and for your support and everybody who's supporting us. The biggest thanks and enjoy the album. I hope you guys like it. And yeah. We leave the metal.
We will see you on a stage soon in Canada and the States.
I promise.